Hi. Hi, my name's Greg McQueen. I'm actually a documentary wedding photographer. And what I actually want to talk to you about today is how the biggest failure of my life has actually now become the biggest inspiration of my life for the kind of photography that it is that I do, which is wedding photography. And to be able to do that, I actually have to take you back a couple of years to a point where I started to realize I was having a problem with stress. And to kind of paint a picture of how bad it was at that time. I had my own business as a photographer, of course. I wasn't really doing wedding photography at that point. I was doing a lot of corporate event photography. So the guys that you see here today, actually doing some video and taking photos, that's actually what I did for about 4 or 5 years to earn my living, actually. And it's weird actually now to be up on stage being photographed. But the really cool thing about that is I actually know how to annoy the fuck out of these guys. Like being the speaker that just, you know, never stands on. Well, there's also the great speaker that just talks in a monitor, doesn't really move their arms or do anything interesting for the 40 minutes that they talk. That's always super nice to photograph. But my favourite actually is the speaker who hasn't really learned what it is that they're going to say, so they spend the whole time doing this, reading it off of their PowerPoint. I've actually photographed all of those in my time. So that was kind of what I had as my full-time business, doing that. On top of that, at that stage, I had a part-time job at Business Academy Aarhus as their in-house photographer. That's a job I still have, actually. I'm pretty lucky that they decided to hang on to me, and you'll kind of hear a little bit about why. I also had a part-time job for an organization called IT Forum, which is basically a local kind of network for the web and IT industry. I was their in-house photographer as well. So that's kind of a full-time business, 2 part-time jobs, a family, and at that point, I decided it was a jolly good idea to do a full-time bachelor degree in innovation and entrepreneurship. And there is another layer to this. I have, and I'm cursed with it, and I'm sure there's a lot of entrepreneurs in the room here today as well, and you're pretty cursed with it too. I have the entrepreneur's brain. And the entrepreneur's brain is basically like a big box of worms. And it's always squirming and squiggling and coming up with new ideas and projects that you want to pursue and hearing other people's projects and ideas and wanting to do those. And so I was also doing a lot of kind of projects over and above that. Some of them were mine and some of them were other people's, and startup weekends, TEDx. If I could say yes to something, it was actually interesting in the first talk, you were talking about saying yes to everything. If I could say yes to something, I would say yes to it. So that was all the things I was doing at the time. So of course, you know, I managed to kind of keep going like this for a while. But eventually, of course, you know, it all started to get on top of me a little bit. I started to have a problem with stress. Now there was a couple of signs of that actually, though, when I started to realize it. One of them was, of course, how busy I was, because you know, when I was supposed to be turning up for class, for example, for my bachelor degree, I wouldn't turn up because I felt, well, I'm so busy, you know, why should I be sitting there for 3 hours in class when I could be doing some other stuff that I'm supposed to be doing? I can always read the book later. So I ended up not turning up for class very much. I found it difficult to actually turn up for the hours at my part-time job at the academy as well. Because I kept thinking, well, you know, I can always do a little bit of work at home on that, and then, you know, while I'm doing that, I can get all these other things done. So while I was supposed to be doing this, I was doing that, and while I was doing that, I was thinking about, you know, the 12 to 15 other things that I was supposed to complete that day. So I was doing a lot of stuff and keeping busy all the time, but not really achieving anything. And I had trouble delivering stuff to clients. I had trouble spending time, proper time with my family. No one was really happy with me at that point because I was just so busy doing stuff but not really achieving anything. And the worst thing was I get to the end of the month and look at my bank account and go, my bank account's empty, I'm working my ass off. Why is my bank account empty? It's because, you know, I was so busy doing stuff, I wasn't really saying yes to a lot of things but not really thinking about why I should be doing it in the first place. So that was kind of one sign that I started to struggle to actually do the things I was taking on board at that time. The second sign is a little bit stranger, actually. I started to get this vision in my head all of the time. Of me being, it was kind of like a mental picture that I had almost every day. And it got to a point where it was constant. I had this mental picture in my head of me kind of being sucked down into this weird kind of vortex. I know that sounds a bit strange, right? But it was like, it was kind of trying to suck me down all the time. I was kind of clawing against the sides of whatever this whole vortex thing was. And just trying to hang on, you know, if I could just hang on and get through the next things, then I'd be okay. And that was kind of a constant mental picture at that point of what was happening to me and how things were going at that time. But it actually took an intervention for me to see just how serious the problem was. And that actually happened in the form of, I got to the end of the second semester for my my bachelor degree in Innovation and Entrepreneurship. And I'd been working on a project with my fellow students for a few months during that semester, of course. We got to the end of the semester and we had the exam. And the exam, the form of the exam was an oral presentation. So we would go in individually, do an oral presentation, and then the examiners and the teachers would then ask you a few questions about the project. I hadn't really contributed very much to the project that we'd been working on because I'd just been so busy doing other stuff. I thought, well, they'll take care of it, I can do a little bit. But I hadn't really made a really decent contribution to it. So what I decided to do for the exam was I thought, okay, what I'll do is I'll go in and I'll do a presentation about stress. I'll do a presentation about how I realize I'm coming down with stress and how that's affected the team, but how the team actually managed to kind of, you know, we had a good team, so they managed to kind of work around it and get on with it. I thought, you know, at least that way, if I get a really crappy mark, it's hopefully not going to affect my teammates because they can realize that I basically didn't do my job as part of the project. So I went into the exam, did my presentation, spoke about stress, presented some lovely kind of facts and figures about how entrepreneurs are actually almost 50% more likely to suffer from stress than anybody else. That's actually true. And they're also almost 50% more likely to suffer from all the things that are related to that. Actually, mood swings and depression and all of that. Actually, just because of the way entrepreneurs are hardwired, their brains aren't wired. And I got to the end of the presentation, and I sat down, and there was two teachers in the room at the time of the examiner. And Peter, who was one of the teachers in the room, he actually said to me, "So, how are you feeling right now, Greg?" And I was like, "Oh, okay, I can answer a few questions about the project." And he leant forward and he looked me straight in the eye. And he said, "I'm very, very sorry, but you've just told us that you're having a problem with stress. So we actually have to stop the exam right now. Because if we ask you some questions, we're going to put you through more stress. And potentially we could do you some harm." And I'm sitting there and I'm like, what do you mean? Just ask me some questions. And I was kind of arguing for it. And I was like, just ask me some questions. I'll be fine. You know, don't worry about it. I just need to get through this and I can move on to the next thing. And there's another teacher in the room, Gita Buell, her name is, she's actually here today. And we were actually good friends as well, we've become good friends. And she reached over and she touched my arm and she said, "Greg, come on." And she led me out of the exam room and sat me down outside. And my classmates were outside and of course they were wondering what the hell is going on. And she actually said to me, "Greg, everyone around you can see that you're not well, so you have to call the doctor. And actually, I'm not going to leave you until you do. You need to do it right now." And I'm like, "Well, what do you mean I need to call the doctor? Just let me back in, you know, I'll be all right." She's like, "Call the doctor." So I took the advice of my good friend and I called the doctor. And I made an appointment for the next day to go and see the doctor. And I went home that night, of course, feeling a little bit confused and bewildered, and you know. But I went to the doctor the next day, thinking, "Okay, you know, it's obvious there's something going on. So let's go and see what's going to happen now." So I went to the doctor, and she did two things. She actually said, "Okay, we need to do a test to figure out, you know, so we can figure out what your mental state is." So she gave me a test to do on paper, actually. She said, "You need to take that home and sit and fill that out, and you bring that back to me tomorrow." And the other thing she said is, "We also need to take a blood test, because we need to figure out whether there's anything physical going on with you that might be causing you know, the stress that you're going through." So she takes the blood, I go home, I do the test, and there was about 25, 30 questions in this test. And I realized pretty quickly as I'm going through the answers, everything was kind of on a scale from 1 to 5. And I'm going through these questions, and it's like 4 or 5 is like the worst. You know, 1 is kind of, everything's okay. So I'm answering these questions, and I'm ticking like 4, 5, 4, 5. And as I'm going through the questions, I start to realize that this test is, it's about more than just figuring out whether you're stressed. Actually, it was a test to really figure out where your mental state is. It was actually a test to figure out whether you were actually suffering from depression. And there was 2 questions in that test that really made me stop and think and realize some things. And one of them was, it actually said, how often do you think about death? And I was like, okay. And I thought about it for a while, and I took to 5. And then the next question on the list actually said, how often do you think about harming yourself? 5. And I started thinking back, and I thought to myself, and I realized that along with this mental picture that I'd had in my head of being sucked down into that weird vortex hole thing, I'd actually thought every day, several times a day, for quite a number of months, about the idea of not being here anymore. That would be one possible solution to all of this. And I don't mean not being here as in just buggering off back to England. I mean actually not being here. And that was a pretty serious realization to have. So I took the test back to the doctor. Of course, she looks through the results and she's like, well, we need to get you into therapy, like, now. And she also said, I'm really sorry to lay this on you, but we have the results of your blood test as well. She said, it's probably brought on by stress and all the things you're going through, but you have diabetes as well. So I came away from the doctor that day realizing that, you know, I had some pretty serious life changes to make. So, luckily, she recommended I go and see a therapist. There's a guy called John in Horsens. And the reason why I had to go kind of that far afield to go and see a therapist was he was an English guy. And on top of that, he actually used to be a photographer. So we had shitloads to talk about when we went to the session. And I saw John for about 4 months. And, yeah, I won't go into a lot of detail about what the therapy was, but when I kind of think about it, I have this vision in my head of, you know, like what a chiropractor does. If you go to a chiropractor, they'll kind of push on your back, kind of get your vertebrae in place, and then kind of make your back feel much better. That's kind of what he did for me emotionally. He just nudged and pushed in a few places through the sessions to kind of get me, not better, but at least lay the foundation for me to start, you know, doing the work that I needed to do to get better. But there's actually a couple of things during the time that I had with John that I want to tell you about. One was the very first session that I had with him, actually, which was, I had this picture in my mind, of course, you know, I'd never been to a therapist or a psychiatrist or anything like that before. And so I had this picture in my mind of, you know, going and lying on a couch and having a guy sit there and like, you know, take notes while I'm talking and yeah, very interesting, yeah. And what happened was when I turned up, it was actually a very ordinary looking office, just 2 chairs in the back, you know, very kind of makeshift looking in some way. And he made me a cup of coffee when I arrived and we chit-chatted a little bit. And we go and sit down at the chairs in the back. That's obviously the place where, you know, all the magic happens. And as we sit down, he says to me, so Greg, how's it hanging? And I'm like, and I look at him, I'm like, and I didn't say this, but in my head, I'm thinking, okay, I'm paying you like 800 kroners an hour, and your opening gambit in our therapy session is, how's it hanging? But I thought, yeah, I'll go with it, I'll see what happens. So I answered the question, I told him how it was, I told him, you know, how it was hanging. I actually didn't stop talking for an hour. I just talked and talked and talked and talked. We actually went over the hour, actually. And that's how the sessions went on. But it went from me kind of talking a lot to starting to have conversations. And I think that's where he started to really, you know, do the work that he needed to do with me. And it got to a point, I remember the very last session we had together, and I didn't know it was going to be the last session. where I turned up, and he had actually bought a new camera. And I think because he knew I'm interested in that kind of thing, he brought it along. So I turn up for the session, and the session starts. He's like, "Hey, Greg, I bought a new camera. Come and check it out." So of course, photographers, we love gear porn, man. We just love new cameras and stuff. So we just stopped looking at this camera. We're checking out this camera. We're talking about it, all the specs and everything. And I take a few photos with it, and we're just talking like two photographers, really. And after a while, he just looks at me and he says, "You don't need me anymore, do you?" And I went, "No, I don't think I do, actually." And that was actually turned out to be the last session. I didn't know it was going to be. But the other thing that was important about the period where I was in therapy was about a couple of months in, I had a day where I basically had an emotional breakdown. I got up that morning. My wife and daughter, they went off to school, my wife went off to work, and my daughter went off to school, or maybe there was other afternoons. I had some things to do that day, because I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a freelancer, so I, even though I was going through all of that, I still had to do a little bit of work, I had to earn some money, So I had a few things to do that day, but they went off, it was about 7 in the morning, that's when you have to leave, for all that family stuff in the morning. And I thought, well, okay, I'm working from home today, and I'm feeling a bit tired, so you know what, I'll go back to bed for half an hour. So I went upstairs, and I'd laid on the bed for a bit. I just, I just got thinking. And I started crying. I couldn't understand why. I literally just started crying, and I carried on, I was crying some more. I kept crying, and I couldn't actually stop. And this went on for hours. And there was one point where my wife called me, just to ask if I'd like do some shopping that day or something very banal. And she could hear what kind of state I was in. I just couldn't stop crying, and I couldn't figure out why. And she got so worried actually that she called my therapist John, and she said to him, "Well, Greg's at home and he's in such a state. Well, what do we do?" And John actually said to her. At that point, he said, "Well, I think he's just having a blowout. He's kind of been getting rid of a lot of feelings and a lot of anxiety and a lot of different things. I think this is the day where he's kind of maybe getting the final parts of it off his chest. So just let it happen, And one of the things I did on that day was I took some photos of myself. And I know you're probably going to think that's weird, but I'm a photographer. I'm a documentary photographer. So I like to document things, and I wanted to document somehow how I felt that day. So I took some photos of myself, and a few days later, I just took them, I didn't really look at them, but a few days later when I was starting to feel okay again, I had looked through the photos, and one of them was this one, actually. And when I saw it, it really struck me. I don't remember I told you earlier about that vision I had in my head of being sucked down into this kind of weird vortex hole. I was there. That's where I was. And the weird thing was, with everything that had gone on with me, I realized that's what I needed to be. Because it was after that day, after having finally got to that bottom, that abyss, wherever it was, emotionally, that's where I really started to feel like I could kind of turn things around again and start to feel better. And I've only actually, I can only actually say, it's only the beginning of this year, which is not that long ago, where I know I've started to feel like myself fully again, actually. But you're probably sitting there right now wondering, how the heck is all that? What the heck has any of that got to do with wedding photography? And how does it actually influence me and inspire me when it comes to wedding photography? There's kind of a few different areas where it inspires me now. One is from a practical point of view. With all the event photography that I used to do and all the other stuff that I used to do, it was really, really difficult to plan my time. For whatever reason, people who organize kind of corporate events, even though they're organizing those things quite far in advance, they would always call last minute. What are you doing in 3 days' time? Or what are you doing tomorrow? Or what are you doing next week? So I was very much kind of at the beck of work-wise, I was very much at the beck and call of all these clients who just wanted you last minute. So it's impossible to plan everything. My calendar is constantly in flux. And if I did plan something, then suddenly a really good job would come in. So then I'd have to change everything again to accommodate that. So my calendar was always, always changing. And that's very, very stressful if you don't know what you're doing from one week to the next and you're having to change things all the time. That in itself creates a great deal of stress. But from a practical point of view, the great thing about wedding photography, and I've changed my entire business now, but 80% of what I do now is wedding photography. I do the occasional corporate event where I pick and choose a bit, but 80% of what I do now is wedding photography. And the real great thing about that is people want to book you months in advance, sometimes a year in advance. So, for example, this year, I can look through from April through to September, which is where the big wedding season is, and I can see where I'm booked. I know what I'm going to be doing in July. I know what I'm going to be doing in August. I know what I'm going to be doing for a couple of weekends in June. So I can actually, I can actually look at my calendar and realize I've got some income coming in there. So if I don't want to work anymore that month, I don't need to. And that's actually, being able to kind of organize myself like that is actually really cut out a lot of stress. The other area where it really inspires me is from a passion point of view. I think partly it was timing. I think about 3 or 4 months into kind of my recovery period, I had some friends of mine approach me and say, "Do you think you could come and photograph our wedding?" I'd never really done weddings before. And I thought to myself, well, I've never done that before. Maybe it might be fun to do. And then I thought, well, weddings and corporate events, they're very, very similar. I mean, a corporate event, an event like this today, for example, it's a one-off thing. If you don't take the photos that you need to take today, you're not going to get the chance again. Weddings are the same, right? It's a one-off event, or hopefully it's a one-off event. So I thought, well, it's not really much different in that way. So I'll give it a go. So I turned up for their wedding. And I shot their wedding, and from the very first picture that I took, I fell in love with it right away, actually. All the little details, all the little relationships that I could see between people. The first wedding picture that I took at that wedding, I turned up, I was outside the town hall in Aarhus, and Powell, who was the groom, he was staying there with his father. His father was actually doing his time, and he'd done it up, and he was looking at it, it wasn't quite straight, so he undone it, and he did it again. And he did this 3 or 4 times. And of course, Powell's standing there saying, stop fussing. And I documented that. I took a few photos of that. And when I looked at them afterwards, I realized that there's something deeper there. Because, of course, this was a father who wasn't, he wasn't just tying a tie. He was actually preparing his son for the life ahead that he was going to have as a husband, as a father, as everything was. And that was his way of doing it. And I realized those are the kind of details and stories that happen at weddings, and it fascinated me. I fell in love with it straight away. So from a passion point of view, I discovered a new passion in photography, which was documentary wedding photography. The third area where it really inspires me, and this is a bit of a fuzzy one, because this is inspiration itself. And of course, most artists, who can't even pronounce the word artist, most artists who, when they try and explain their influences and their inspiration, it gets a little bit fuzzy. So I'll try and kind of explain it in a way that makes sense. What I realized was that during my time in therapy and all the things that I went through there, in order for me to get better, I had to really confront some things about myself. We're all aware of this idea that we wear a psychological mask, right? So when you're out in the world and you're visiting friends and you're seeing people, you put on this kind of mask to get through the day. And you put on this, sometimes you try and portray this kind of perfect version of yourself for everyone to see. And I had to basically rip that off and really confront some things about myself and some truths about myself, some failures and everything about myself to understand who I was in order to get better. What I realized was, when I started looking at wedding photography and realizing this is something I really wanted to do, was I started seeing a lot of very traditional wedding photos. A couple standing by a tree looking all romantic. Or, the couple actually kind of, walking along some railway tracks kind of way. Smiling and romantic. Those kind of very classical wedding images that you see. And I thought, well, they're creating a mask too, right? That's fiction. I mean, they're creating this kind of very fairy tale romantic view of their wedding day. I can imagine couples who have those kind of pictures done. They look back on their pictures and they're like, oh, what a perfect romantic day we had. Oh, it was lovely. I don't know if anyone here has actually got married or has had to organise their wedding day, but it's the most fucking stressful thing you've ever done in your entire life. It is. I think on the list of like stress things, it's like number two or number one on the stress, you know, counter of how stressful it is to actually organise. And even on the wedding day itself, you know, you're taking one of the biggest leaps in your lifetime. So you're going to be nervous. There's a whole roller coaster ride of emotions that people go through on a wedding day. And I thought, well, what I want to do is like I had to rip my mask off. I want to rip the mask off the wedding day. And I want to show all of that. I want to show that it's stressful. I want to show that people get anxious. I want to show this roller coaster ride of emotions from being super happy to bickering to everything else that goes on a wedding day. That's what I want to capture. And that's what I actually started doing when I photographed weddings. And I actually have I brought some of my photos here today, actually, just out here. And hopefully you can see that in some of the photos. There's none of the photos out there where you see a couple standing looking very smiley and happy. It really kind of portrays that, you know, that emotional kind of blanket that you have on a wedding day. And that's what I really, really set out to capture. So that's how kind of my story of going through stress, depression, an emotional breakdown, all of that has actually now become something that just inspires me when it comes to running my business and inspires me as an artist when it comes to pursuing documentary wedding photography. Thank you very much.